Hello and welcome to my very first YouTube video. My name is Camille and I'm here in Quirin, Ireland on the Loophead Peninsula, and it's quite cold today, so I won't spend much time here. Radar segment. In this segment, I will always introduce people that are inspiring me. And one of the purposes of my channel is to inspire you. So I hope that you enjoy this interview that I did recently with Ragnar Axelsson via Zoom. And we talked a little bit about his new book, and it's fantastic. I just received it in the mail, and I will show that to you when I'm back in the house and it's not so cold. So with that, enjoy Ragnar's interview, and I'll see you after that.
In Huitaman in Winged Creek.
Mér finnst mikilvægt að dokumentera þetta líf hér og eins og þessi grænlenski hundur sem mjög merkileg, ensta hundategund í heiminum og einhver harðgerasta dýr bara sem hann finnur.
Try to imagine waking up in a small cabin in the northernmost village in the world. It's pitch black, it's bitterly cold, the wind is blowing outside, and the only sound you hear is a lonesome dog howling. Slowly, more and more dogs wake up, and the sound, it's getting louder, and it's like a choir. What are they saying? It's like they are telling you something. I have been photographing in Greenland in the Arctic for more than 40 years, mainly focusing on the people and the hunters, and the dogs, of course, but suddenly you realize how big hero this Greenlandic dog is. Because of him, man could reach both poles. It was the dog, the Greenlandic sled dog, who took people to the North Pole and to the South Pole. After having been photographing in the Arctic for such a long time, I started hearing stories from the hunters about the dog, and you start to think, well, this is a great story. You look at a dog as a dog, but sometimes you hear stories from the hunters telling you that they're almost human in some cases. They were clever, and when you're out on the ice, it's your best friend. And when all hope was over, the dog took you home. Some of those stories are remarkable. These are the Arctic heroes.
Það mjög erfitt að mynda í þessar aðstæður og að smella myndum með þessum stóru lúfum. er eins og bara að sauma saman mann með boxum. Það er svo skrítið þegar maður er í svona kulda og svona stór hríð og nærfa allan andanum að þegar maður er komin heim þá dreymir maður aftur og komin.
There you go.
Oh, there you go. Can you see me?
I can.
Camille, I was supposed to be at home, but I've been so busy, so I'm driving, actually. But is that okay with you?
Yeah, actually, it's kind of cool.
Okay, great. I'm here with my friend. We are. There's a storm, actually, in Iceland, and we're saving things from blowing away.
It must be beautiful.
Oh, yes, it is. But it's been stormy for some time.
We get your weather about a day later, so it will be stormy here probably tomorrow.
Ah, okay. Okay.
So,
yeah.
Thank you very much for allowing me to do this. I am. You inspire me, and I have great respect for your entire body of work, so...
Oh, thank you. I've seen your work from both Antarctica and the Arctic. Beautiful photographs. So.
Thank
the
you.
The icebergs, I love it. Love it. I've been there on both places, so I know how much joy it is to photograph that. Actually.
Yeah, and so one of the things that appeals to me personally about your work is the marriage of sort of a documentary photojournalistic style with a really soulful kind of approach.
Thank you.
Would you talk a little bit about what drew you to photograph Greenland?
I read the books about when I was a kid. I was reading books about the great explorers who was there, you know, Knut Rasmussen, Peter Freuchen. And then there were great explorers like Sir Wally Herbert that went to the North Pole with dogs and back and forth. It interested me a lot. But when I was young, I was learning to fly, and I flew with my friends few flights, like ambulance flights to Greenland as a, you know, collecting hours because they were always alone. So it was like a co-pilot with them. And that was my first trip to journey and my journeys to Greenland. And I started photographing there early. And it wasn't much of a hero to me then, in the beginning, when I went to Kulusuk in that place. But when I went to Thule in 86, that was really something. I mean,
yeah.
big people and great people and great hunters and friendly. And that was what excited me, is to photograph. Because most photographers, when I was growing up as a photographer, everybody went to Africa. And when you were there, it was like the whole world of photographers were in Africa taking the same photographs. So I wanted to go in a different direction. That's the reason I started going more and more to Greenland and photograph in the Arctic and the colder places, because it was both challenging, it was difficult and hard. And when you got like bad weather and stuff like that, you got really good photographs, I felt. And that was something that I liked very much.
Being from Iceland, having been to Iceland and Greenland, there are similarities and there are great differences. Do you think that informed your aesthetic or not at all?
Well, it did. You know, when I was a kid, I grew up on a farm in the summertime and under the glaciers, and the bridges. There were no bridges to cross the glacial rivers, so I was. Riding horses, and I was always playing, you know, like I was an Indian, you know, in the wilderness, and it was so much fun. And I had similarities with the glaciers in Iceland and Greenland, but it's 20 times bigger in Greenland, so it was overwhelming coming there. But it was, you know, when I grew up, and I loved the glaciers and and being on them and the rivers and the landscape and the beauty of the nature. It was something that, you know, excited me. But I got very early on excited about the life of people and getting and photographing people in their environment. That's because it's changing. And I was thinking, well, how does this look like in 50 years or 100 years? And it has changed a lot because now you can drive, which you could not before. I had to go on an old Douglas DC-3 to the farm when I was a kid. And so now you can drive there in 3-4 hours, which it took me a long time to get to that place. But it was great to grow up in a, you know, on a farm isolated with animals and the nature. And that was like kickstarting me. And I got found old magazines, Life magazines on the loft and Stern. So and looking at the photographs, it was so exciting to see. And one of my favorite photographers is W. Eugene Smith, which I found an issue. And the pictures were like, wow, this is great. This is something I want to do.
So of course, he was black and white photography. And you do a lot of black and white.
I do a lot of black and white. I do a lot of black and white.
And what is it that still attracts you to black and white?
Because I had so much fun making the atmosphere in the photograph in the darkroom. I grew up, I have thousands of hours in the darkroom printing, and I even flew once to New York. I flew to New York just to see Eugene Smith's prints in a gallery, and then flew back, and I went straight into the darkroom. Mary Ellen Mark was a friend of mine and my mentor and teacher for a while, and she always came here to Iceland, and her passion in photography was, you know, it was absolutely something. It was a drive to me and for everybody, I think. And those photographers were beautiful. They're beautiful work. And black and white and being in a darkroom is something that I like very much. I like black and white for me personally, even though there are so many great color photographs and photographers. But black and white is kind of something. It's like writing a song. You want to write your song instead of writing a song to please someone. If people like it, that's good. But if it don't, it will be my way of expressing myself.
Exactly. And so I think you kind of covered why you, it sounds like you always wanted to be a photographer, but more importantly, what is it that makes a satisfying image for you?
Oh, I'm searching for it all my life. I think it will take a lifetime, but, what I feel like I tried to get, I looked a lot on art books, like at paintings. Like if you look at like Rembrandt painting, like Night Watch, you can see he was painting, you know, when he was on our planet, he was painting and the time he was living on and the expression on faces and the light in his pictures. And that's something for me that I want to get the moments on if I take a photograph of somebody in their environment. I wait for the moments. Like you have seen so many great, like Cartier-Bresson, how they photograph and wait for the snap at the right moment. And that moment is something, you never know whether it's going to be an iconic photograph or not. There are few, and photography has changed the world and will change it again. So it opens people's eyes. And I think it's important to, at least for me, I try to get the expression on people's faces and try to get and so they're saying something, and also the light. And that's where the darkroom comes. I do what I can. Today I use digital, but I work on the photograph just like I could do in a darkroom. I don't go over the edge. You can see photographs a lot today with it's like from another planet sometimes, because the colors you see don't exist on this one. So people can do whatever they like. And if they have it like their own work, but in documentary work I couldn't do that. You have to be honest. So
exactly.
And that I'm just trying to get together in a one photograph, like expression on people and the moments, right moments, and beautiful light or bad weather or whatever. Like in Greenland, I tried to photograph the hunters. Now I did a new book called Arctic Heroes. It's about the Greenlandic sled dog, a tribute to him, because he is probably one of the biggest heroes in the Arctic. He took people to the North Pole and to the South Pole, and you look at a dog as a dog, but the stories they told me, it's like some kind, they're like humans. They're so, some of them are so clever. And when all hope was over, the dog took you home in a storm. So I tried to photograph them in a storm and in the bad, as worse, in bad conditions, as worse as they can get, just to show how their life really is, just to open people's eyes for the Arctic. And I think everybody is doing photographs in the Arctic and Antarctica. Just, it's a little piece in a puzzle, and everybody's doing. So it, everybody's doing their own work. And together, it's like many poodle dogs barking, telling you and telling people what is happening.
Yes.
So, yeah, I thought it's very important to show it. And the stories that I got from the hunters, from the dogs, are so beautiful. That and like one friend of mine, Ule, it was hard to get those stories, because for them, they felt like, oh, it was like for us going shopping.
Exactly.
Because they have to go out. I don't hunt myself, but I have to respect them for having to do it. You know, they can't go and do whatever we can do. So, and this community is kind of going down. There were 30,000 dogs 10 years ago. Now they are 11 or 12,000. So it is declining, and the ice is thinning. So it's getting harder for the hunters, and the young generation, they will get a, you know, new kinds of life. So it is a lot of changes happening in this area and in all the Arctic countries, I think, when it comes to this. But Ule, my friend, who told me one story of like his dog can do, he didn't want to tell me stories. He said, they're all going with me. And I asked him to just write them down for his kids or grandchildren, just, you know, to know how great he was. And he thought about it. And the next day, I've been there like for a year to get stories from him. And he told me stories, a few stories. And one of the stories was about this dog, Kendu, which was a very clever dog, his best friend, and how he dies in the end. And when he finished that story, he was crying. He passed away. He died 40 years ago. And he said, I'll tell you more stories next time when you come. He had told me a few, but there were no next time. He passed away a few months later. So some of the stories went with him, as he said in the beginning.
That's.
But I got a few.
Yeah, that's really the hard part is, you know, you're not just losing those stories, you're losing the wisdom and the experience.
Yeah.
And so
and nobody knows actually, you know, how clever. I mean, the story is like a Disney movie sometimes, some of the stories they are saying. Yeah. You know about Basto and those dogs who, you know, rescued like a gnome when there was a disease and the dogs rescued the children. It was a virus or something.
Yes.
And those dogs are absolutely the same. You know, they were in moments that nobody have heard about. Yeah. So those stories are really something, and I have few more that are not in the book, but I will write it in the next book about if I'm photographing all the 8 Arctic countries. So I'll put stories from each country. So I keep 2 stories, which are good stories, you know, to have, you know.
I have the Last Days of the Arctic, and that was just such a stunning book. So I'm excited for
that too. We did another one, Faces of the North. It was thicker, and there was more stories in it. I wrote more stories. I started writing stories, too, because I feel like sometimes photographs get a little bit, you know, life when you tell stories, you know, to add something to the photographs. That's how it, I mean, I as much as I love photography and I collect photographic books and watch photographers around the world. I think it will be adding something to write. It's not like a family album with a family you don't know anything about. It's when you put something in it, a story behind the pictures, it gives it a little extra life, I think, because I feel that text and photographs shouldn't be enemies. It should be friends.
Absolutely.
<know?
laughs> Absolutely. So one other question I have for you, and now, how would you...
You know, photography is, it's a passion, you know, and I think everybody who's young photographers should, you know, it was a fight for me when I was, you know, having to be able, everybody was saying, why are you doing it? It's nuts. And I don't know. It's not. I'm stubborn, kind of, because I didn't quit photographing in the Arctic, going to Greenland over and over again, Siberia, whatever. But a lot of people said this is stupid. But I knew what would happen because I heard it from people living there. They were walking on those melting pages. So when you hear from them that something's happening, you have to, you know, be aware. Oh, where is it going? I'm gonna document it. And in the end, so you have to be passionate. Have passion what you're doing and just believe in what you're doing. I know it's photography is kind of fighting for its life in a way because of magazines and newspapers, but when one door closes, another one opens up. And like in the internet, you see so many great photographers on the internet, but Instagram and whatever. So they are getting more chances than they wouldn't have got before. But we have to live. I love doing books. I mean, it's not, I have fun doing it. You have it in your hands. It's like having a little kid, you know, newly born. It's fun to have it, but it's a long way sometimes. It's hard, but it's fun.
Yes. If it was easy, everyone would do it.
yeah, that's right. Maybe. But I think, in photographic books are more expensive than usually books that you're just reading because the printing of photographs is expensive.
Yes.
And I think photographic books need also just to get more viewers is to write also a little bit, not much text, but just something to explain things to, you know, yes. Then you get like when we did the Faces of the North, we printed it with just photographs, very short stories. They didn't believe in the stories in the beginning that it should be, but I was always, then we redid it and did it and added more photographs. It was thicker and I wrote stories that I had written down when I was there and it sold out like four times. It's a huge, edition of it, gone, 30,000, 40,000, whatever, I don't know.
Amazing.
So it was because of writing also, it added to the photographs and gave them life. But I always enjoy watching just photographs. But I sometimes, when I see a photograph, I want to know a little bit more. And we got a lot of more people who wanted to, buy the book because of they wanted to read about this kind of life.
Yes. And so my final question is, what inspires you and what troubles you?
Oh, there's so much that inspires me. I watch a lot of photographers, you, for instance, and many, and you're doing great things. And I watch young kids coming up, young photographers, and they have such a great eye. And I watch I read the old masters, Don McCullen, you know, Eugene Smith, Mary Ellen, and they're so great. But what is bothers me is the attitude towards photography. I think magazines and newspapers would be in a better position if they would have used pictures better instead of, you know, trying to, because to go somewhere, it costs money, but it sells too.
Yeah.
So that's the only thing that troubles me. But when you see the world is more or less about some celebrities and some of them even, they're famous for being famous. They don't even know themselves what they're famous for. And some of them haven't even done anything. So that's really something that I felt quite strange because in the meantime, you lose great people doing great things and they will be in the movie in 100 years. You know. So I think, but we have to just, you know, never give up. Just do what you feel like doing and it pays off in the end. That's my belief. And just have a passion for what you do. Like Mary Ellen, she was, you know, before she passed away, she was so passionate till the end. And it was great. She had more power than we do. I was training for my trips. I was out running, jogging. I was swimming in the ocean every day, no matter how cold it was. But she had much more power than I ever did. I really loved her. She was a beautiful woman and one of the best photographers ever.
That's really, thank you for sharing that about her.
She was nice.
So where exactly are you in Iceland? And then I'll let you go. Like right now, where are you?
I'm now in Reykjavik. I am in Reykjavik now. I've been driving around the country. I was I've been photographing the situations we're in, the COVID thing. I've been put in spacesuit, you know, photograph people with the COVID virus and following through people. And some have passed away. Others, we are getting on the track now, so it's getting better. And I think we will be over it by the end of the year.
Good.
So I hope so. So it's looking good, kind of. So, yeah. We have to be positive, you know. It's
It
all things must pass.
Yes. Well, thank you very much for doing this. You have no idea how much I appreciate it.
So thank you, Camille. Thank you very much.
Okay. So, yeah, I love Ragnar's work. And look what just arrived. I'm so excited. And we're going to open this right here, right now. Is an image I saw many years ago, but it is my absolute favorite. It's actually a horizontal. It's actually a horizontal image, but on the book for the cover they made it a vertical. But I highly recommend, you know, if you want to learn about soul in your imagery, Ragnar is really good at exemplifying that in his work. And if you spend any time with me, you will know that for me, it's not about how sharp an image is. I have seen so many images that are tack sharp and have no soul. So if there's a lesson from today and Ragnar's work, it's somehow getting some of that soulfulness, that trying not to control everything in your images so that it gives an emotion, because the truth is, if you cannot make someone feel something with your images, you have failed. It doesn't matter how much information is there, how sharp it is, how good the composition. If you don't feel anything, it's failed. So I hope you enjoyed this very first episode. It is much longer than I intended, but that opportunity to interview Ragnar just couldn't be passed up. My next episode, I will talk a little bit more about what brought me to Ireland and what am I doing here. So look for that one. If you like what I'm doing here and you're curious, you want to learn more, hit the subscribe button and or like it, don't like it, it's fine. But I do appreciate you spending your time here and I hope that it was inspiring for you. Until next time, thank you.